In this short presentation, we will look at the nerves involved in voluntary control and involuntary control of micturition, and the nerves involved in male sexual function. So let's begin by looking at the structures that are represented in this diagram. First of all, there's the bladder, represented by this yellow-filled circle over here. Out of it comes the urethra, and labeled it there with two arrows. At the base of the bladder is the sphincter vesicae. The sphincter vesicae is formed from smooth muscle and is integrated into the base of the bladder, where it functions to close off the neck of the bladder when the presence of urine is minimal. In contrast, below that is the sphincter urethri, and this is part of the urogenital diaphragm. The urogenital diaphragm is made up of striated muscle and is therefore under voluntary control. It is therefore necessary for us to learn to use the sphincter urethri as we get older, and this typically happens during the time of potty training in the child. So to summarize, the muscles that will be involved in micturition will be those of the bladder, which is a smooth muscle structure under autonomic control, the sphincter vesicae, which is part of the bladder musculature and under autonomic control, and then the urogenital diaphragm, which contains the sphincter urethri, through which the urethra runs, is made up of striated muscle under voluntary control. So let's now go on and have a look at the role of the sympathetic part of the autonomic nervous system and its role in the control of micturition. The sympathetic nervous system, you will recall, originates from the spinal cord from levels T1 down to L2. So the fibers that are represented over here, L1 and L2, will be coming out of the spinal cord at approximately this level over here. They will be running out of the spinal cord, coming to the first synapse, this ganglion over here, and the second neuron will then run out, one going to the bladder, and another one going off down to the sphincter vesicae. The effect of the sympathetic nervous system on the bladder causes the bladder wall to relax. That's what this minus sign here indicates. Whereas the fibers going to the sphincter vesicae cause this sphincter at the base of the bladder, this involuntary sphincter, to contract. Now, this is the state of affairs when the bladder is empty and urination is not intended to take place. So think of a little baby who's just passed urine. The baby doesn't continue urinating as a continuous dribble all the time. What will happen is, when the bladder is empty, these inhibitory influences will cause the bladder wall to relax and the sphincter vesicae to remain closed until such time as the bladder distends with urine and the reflexes then change. These changes happen because of the parasympathetic nervous system. You may recall that the parasympathetic nervous system arises from the brain and from the spinal cord. From the spinal cord, there are three nerve roots, S2, 3, and 4, which come out of the spinal cord to supply structures in the pelvic region. And there are four cranial nerves which come out of the brain, that is to say cranial nerves 3, that's the oculomotor nerve, 7, which is the facial nerve, 9, which is the glossopharyngeal nerve, and 10, which is the vagus nerve. These cranial nerves, however, do not influence us when looking at micturition. The parasympathetic nervous system acts under peaceful conditions, so that when it's appropriate for somebody to urinate, for example, when the bladder is full, then the parasympathetic nervous system will have a stimulatory effect on the bladder wall musculature, causing it to contract, and at the same time an inhibitory effect on the action of the sphincter vesicae, causing it to open. And this diagram also reminds us of the fact that the parasympathetic nervous system has long preganglionic neurons and short postganglionic neurons for their action. So now let's have a look and see how the two systems stack up in reality. So let's go back to the example of the little baby again. When the bladder is empty, the sympathetic nervous system has a predominant action, causing inhibition of contraction of the bladder wall and contraction of the sphincter vesicae. As urine is produced, the bladder increases in size, which results in an inhibition of the sympathetic output and an increase in parasympathetic output. Now, the parasympathetic system here will cause the bladder wall to contract and thus start the process of urination, and at the same time the inhibitory fibers over here causing the sphincter vesicae to open will allow the urine to go to the outside. Let's look now at the voluntary control of micturition. The input for the voluntary control of micturition comes from fibers S234, which happen to be the same nerve fibers as carry parasympathetic fibers, but of course their arrangement is different. Here the single axon comes down and is stimulatory to the sphincter urethrae, thus closing off the urethra and preventing urination. So in the event that there's pressure to urinate because the bladder is full, the sphincter urethrae acts as a last defense, as it were, to urination and enables urination to occur at a socially and practically opportune time. Now, in this diagram, you can see everything put together. You can see the input from the sympathetic system, the input from the parasympathetic system, which stimulates urination and counteracts effects to inhibit urination. And finally, you can see the somatic pathway here coming down to activate the sphincter urethrae. So, if the parasympathetic system stimulates urination, the somatic nervous system can impede it until an opportune moment arises. When one wants to urinate, then the output from the pudendal nerve can be eliminated, allowing the sphincter urethrae to relax and for the urine then to pass through. This information on micturition is true for both male and female alike. However, let's use some of this information to understand the process of male sexual functioning a little better. In the interests of accuracy, we need to include a prostate gland, which I'll put in here. Notice that it comes between the base of the bladder, formed by the sphincter vesicae, and the urogenital diaphragm, which is represented here. So the prostate lies in between here, with the prostatic urethra running between the two. Now, at the start of a sexual arousal phase in the male, the parasympathetic system will send its output to the blood vessels, to the arterioles, supplying the penis, causing them to dilate and increasing the blood flow going to the erectile tissue. This will cause the penis to start to enlarge in size. So if I can just represent the urethra here and the green pointing up to help you remember that the parasympathetic contributes towards the formation of erection. As the blood flows into the penis, the erectile tissue will distend and will put some pressure on the dorsal veins in the penis, draining, thus slightly impeding the flow of blood coming from the penis. So both the dilatation of the arterioles and the slight constriction of the veins leaving the penis allows it to remain in a state of erection. The parasympathetic system will continue to stimulate the glands that are within the region, so the prostate gland, the seminal vesicles, the testes, they will be stimulated to secrete whatever is necessary to contribute towards the seminal fluid. As the state of arousal increases, stimulation of the glands of the penis will cause a reflex stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system, which will send impulses to the smooth muscle in the vas deferens and the seminal vesicles to the prostate, causing the secretions that are being produced to be pushed out into the prostatic urethra. This is a process known as emission. Note that with sympathetic output, there is also a stimulation of the internal sphincter over here, the sphincter vesicae, the base of the bladder, which will cause it to close off. Therefore, during the period of emission, when fluid is forced under sympathetic action into the prostate, it's not going to ejaculate out into the bladder in a retrograde place, but continue on the normal path of least resistance, which will be to go out through the urethra via the penis. Following on from emission, the process of ejaculation will occur and is experienced as an orgasm. During this process, the somatic nervous system causes contraction of the ischiocavernosus and bulbospongiosus muscles. This puts pressure onto the erectile tissue and helps in expelling the seminal fluid through the urethral meatus. Also continuing during this time is the sympathetic output causing further emission. So to summarize here the various roles played by the different parts of the nervous system, you just remember that the parasympathetic nervous system is responsible for sexual arousal. It causes the process of erection to occur by dilating the arterioles and enhancing blood supply to the penis. It also encourages the formation of secretions that contribute to the seminal fluid. The sympathetic nervous system is important in causing emission, in that it sends the various fluids along into the prostatic urethra, at the same time closing off the neck of the bladder to prevent retrograde ejaculation. The somatic nervous system plays a role by innervating the ischiocavernosus and bulbospongiosus muscles to contract at the time of orgasm, and other muscles within the pelvic cavity. But as part of this somatic reflex, there is no contraction of the external urethral sphincter. It would not make sense for the sphincter to contract, and so this part of the pathway is not in operation during ejaculation. Otherwise, fluid would be caught between the two sphincters, the sphincter vesicae and the external urethral sphincter, and wouldn't be going anywhere, when the whole idea is for it to come out and go off and do what it has to do. From the information contained within this presentation, one can see that there are many systems which, if interfered with, could adversely affect sexual function in the male and bladder function in the male or female. Psychological stressors can affect both the autonomic and somatic nervous systems, and there are many drugs that have autonomic side effects that can either enhance or inhibit parasympathetic and sympathetic divisions of the nervous system. So it's important for us to be aware of these and understand the roles of many different agents in their potential side effects on the functioning of the genitourinary system. This slide forms the end of this presentation, which I hope has been helpful.